High King of Heaven, we love to sing praises to you. We rejoice in you, our Maker. We exalt you, our King. We praise your name, for you delight in your people. We do not deserve to come into the presence of the Holy God of the universe, but you have crowned the humble with victory. You have lifted up those who are bowed down. You have clothed us in your righteousness. We come before you with confidence, not based on ourselves, but based on your mercy and grace. Let your praises be on our lips and on our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. It is a great joy that you are able to join us online. Today is the second week of Advent. It is the Advent of peace. Peace is the light that sheds understanding. Peace is the promise of God. Peace is found when God's order and justice are brought to the world. We await the birth of the Prince of Peace. Let us pray. Source of light, shine in our lives and in your world with your everlasting peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Our reading is from Malachi chapter 3, verses 1 to 4. I will send my messenger who will prepare the way for me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites and refine them like gold and silver. Then the Lord will have men who will bring offerings in righteousness, and the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord, as in the days gone by, as in the former years. These are the words of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Song.
Let us say the prayer of confession. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And apart from your grace, there is no health in us. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare all those who confess their faults. Restore all those who are penitent according to your promises. Declare to all people in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may now live a godly, righteous, and sober life. To the glory of your holy name, amen. Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God in a moment of silence. Grant to your faithful people, merciful Lord, pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins, serve you with a quiet mind, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us say the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, begotten from the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made. Of the same essence as the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. He became incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made human. He was crucified for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again with glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life. He proceeds from the Father, and with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified. He spoke through the prophets. We believe in one holy, universal, and apostolic church. We affirm one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look forward to the resurrection of the dead, and to the life in the world to come. Amen.
The reading is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 3, reading from verse 1 to 6. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod Tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip Tetrarch of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias Tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of the Lord came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the country around Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, "Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked roads shall become straight, the rough ways smooth. And all the people will see God's salvation. This is the word of the Lord.
So Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be holy and pleasing and acceptable to you, through Christ our Saviour. Amen. As we continue our journey through the Advent season and the light of Christ becomes just that little bit brighter, we focus today on peace. It's no coincidence that this theme is traditionally linked with that of John the Baptist on the second Sunday of Advent. Ray and I went several years ago to Israel. We took one of those pilgrimage tours and we're really blessed that somebody paid for that, for us to go. It is something that I truly recommend, as it opens one's eyes to the landscape and the geography described in the Bible. It can even open up new meaning for the scripture texts that we read so often, as you start to get a picture of how things may have looked. As someone who is very interested in the historical background of the Bible, I found our time there to be absolutely fascinating. For some of that time, we entered into Jordan, the country, and went to the traditional baptismal site. Now, it may be a few coordinates off from where things actually happened, we don't know, but it is at least very close to where Jesus was baptized and where John the Baptist plied his trade. Though it was springtime at the time, I can tell you it was extremely hot and muggy. The desert air seemed thick, hard even to breathe. I had a lovely swim in the warm waters of the Jordan, but the moment I got out, I just felt like I'd been in a tumble dryer. Everything dissipated so quickly. The Jordan was, of course, the only respite from the heat, which was in the 40s on that day. It's in this very desert that John called people to be baptized. But he wasn't calling them just to come and have a dip to cool off. There was something really meaningful about what he called them to. We know a little bit about John the Baptist, of course, and can deduce quite a lot from what we read in the scriptures. He was Jesus' cousin, as we know, and he seems to have been quite eccentric. After all, he had a funny diet of locusts and honey. He also had long hair, and in Matthew's gospel, we hear about how he wore clothes made from camel's hair. I get itchy just thinking about that. Now, baptism is not a new phenomenon. It predates Christianity. You know, the Jews would perform a cleansing with water when non-Jews were converting to Judaism. And that was also called baptism. There was also a monastic type of group that lived in the desert, in that very desert, known as the Essenes. This community would undertake daily baptisms. In fact, it seems like twice a day, as a sign of cleansing. Now, if you visit Masada, for instance, which is where this community lived, you can see large pits with steps going down into the pit. And what they would do is they would line up and they would walk one by one into that pit, which was filled with water. And so their heads would be underwater, and then they would sort of turn around and walk up another set of steps and back out of the pit. This is very well described, of course, in the writings of the Essenes. There are extensive archaeological records there, and this is in fact the community that gave us the Dead Sea Scrolls. In my own research, I've concluded that John the Baptist was likely an Essene, at least at some point in his life. Baptism would have been important to him. But perhaps he broke away after a while. His baptism was a little bit different from that sort of ritual baptism, which seemed to be so that people could partake fully in the worship life. But John's was different. He felt a strong call to take baptism to the people. You see, the Essene community was a fairly closed community. And he also added a new level to the meaning of what baptism was about. Instead of being some mysterious ritual to be cleansed so that one could worship, he used it as a call to repentance that their sins may be forgiven. There's a subtle but important difference here. The Holy Spirit has moved John to identify that a ritualistic outward cleansing is not enough. Like prophets before him, he calls people to personal and collective accountability and to take responsibility for their faith. And that's important. The people of God need to turn to God, to repent. In other words, they need to change direction. In doing so, in repenting and turning back to God, forgiveness becomes possible. In fact, with God, it becomes inevitable. And for John, the outward sign of the waters of baptism point to a deep inner reality, something truly meaningful. Baptism becomes for him a sign of commitment to this life of repentance and leaning towards God. John's Baptist call isn't a new one. Many prophets before him called the people to change their ways, to change their attitudes. Do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God, we hear from Micah. Or these words from Isaiah 40 that should ring a bell to you today, because Luke repeats them. He links those words with John the Baptist in the gospel reading. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare a way for the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Don't you just love those words? The purpose of the making straight is so that the glory of the Lord will be revealed and all people will see it together. I think it's a marvelous image. Basically, this passage is about clearing the path for God to enter in. Sometimes I hear people interpret it as, well, God straightens the paths. God straightens out our lives and sorts out the issues that we have. Well, my experience is God doesn't always do that, and certainly quickly at least. But as true as that can be at times, that God maybe straightens our lives and sorts out our issues, it's not what Isaiah is saying, and it's not what Luke means either when he links this with John the Baptist. He is clearly telling God's people to prepare the path for God to enter in. It is us that need to make the path straight, not God. This is about ushering in the new age, the kingdom of God. It's about preparing the way. And John tells us how. John the Baptist. Through a baptism of repentance, through that commitment to repentance and this new life of leaning into God. This call is just as important to us today. I love the analogy of the voice calling in the desert. There are so many voices in our world that call us away from God. Last week I mentioned the commercial voices that turn Christmas into a big spending circus. But there are others too. Political voices, social media, twisted religious ideology, and society in general as well. They all seek to drown out the voice that is calling from the desert. These voices bring discord and restlessness into our lives. They unsettle us, in fact, if we really look at it closely. In the words of a song called Whisper by this folk artist, Passenger, he says, "All I need's a whisper in a world that only shouts." We need to tune into God at this time, as I said last week in the message. That's what Advent is for. It's about preparing the way for the Lord. But God's call to repentance is one also that brings us inner peace. John heeded Isaiah's call and lived these words, calling those who heard him to repent and to begin anew, to prepare the way. In so doing, he invited more and more people to join him in living Isaiah's words. And so the way became clear for God to enter in. John's call prepared people for Jesus to come, for him to minister, to heal the sick, to usher in God's kingdom. Are you ready? How have you been making paths straight for God? How have you been making the valleys higher and the mountains lower so that Jesus can enter into your life? Do you need to turn away from something, sin, distractions, in order to receive him fully? These are important questions. As we continue our journey this season, I want to encourage you to do something about it. Really. Repent and lean back into God. Turn to him. Because he is gracious and merciful and abounding in steadfast love. Use this time as we lead into Christmas to prepare. Go in peace. Amen.
Let us pray. Jesus, you rode to your birth on a donkey, held in the silent safety of Mary's womb. Remind us that we are mothers and fathers, innkeepers, and census takers, preparing this world for your arrival. This Advent, help us be mindful of the world we are creating, for you to enter into once again. Holy God, Help us to clear space in our lives where your holy presence may grow and produce fruit worthy of our great calling. Remove far from us those things which cause hurt to others and hurt ourselves. Plant seeds of joy and peace, that love may grow and be shown as we live in harmony with others. We thank you, generous God, for the world in which we live. We praise you for the beauty of the seasons, with the varied opportunities which they provide to enjoy creation. We give thanks for night and day, a time for rest and sleep, and a time for play and work. We give thanks for people, all so wonderfully different, yet each created in your image. We give thanks for Jesus, our Savior, at his birth in Bethlehem, a star lit up the sky, who died on a cross to show such great love to us all. Eternal God, in the darkness of winter and in the darkness of our broken world, the light of Jesus shines to give us courage and hope. Light up our hearts as we praise you and our minds as we hear your word. Give strength, we pray, to those who seek to bring your light into the dark places of our world. Bless those who are called upon to fight as they serve in armies in conflict zones. Give wisdom to those politicians and world leaders who negotiate to bring about reconciliation. Strengthen all those who work to protect the vulnerable and show compassion to those whose lives have been subject to physical and spiritual distress. We pray that your Holy Spirit works in us to help us serve you day by day. Give us eyes to see you at work in our lives and those around us. May the joy of your salvation burn brightly in our soul, so that your lost children would be drawn closer to you. God of power and mercy, open our hearts in welcome. Remove the things that hinder us from receiving Christ with joy, so that we may share his wisdom and become one with him when he comes in glory, for he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
We who walk in darkness deep now see the light of morning. The mighty God, the Prince of Peace, a child to us is born. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away our sin. Behold the voice is crying, prepare the way, make straight the path, your King has come to die. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away our sin.
Thank you for joining us on this online service. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Rejoice, rejoice.